Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Exploring English Food and Culture Facebook Live. I'm joined by Claire, Chris, and Sally. Hello, everyone.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
And we're here to talk about our fantastic free online course, which is still open to join, and to answer all of your questions or share any information that you want about the UK food culture, language, vocabulary, anything like that that you want to ask about. So get your questions ready, post them in the comments, and we'll try and answer as many as we can. But first, I'm going to go to Claire to find out what we've been looking at this week on the course. So Claire, over to you.
I think this is my favorite week of the course, because this week is all about special occasions and how we often celebrate these with special food. So there's quite a lot about Christmas and Christmas dinner, but also other special days like birthdays and the food that we eat. We talk about puddings and sweet things, which I absolutely love. We talk about tea and coffee. And then we're also going back to talking about different regional food around the UK. So I'm just having a really good time this week talking about cakes.
Okay, I'm not like Tina, I'm not a big sweet or cake eater, so the coffee and tea part is the most interesting part for me. Chris and Sally, in any conversations or any particular highlights from the week that you've noticed, Chris?
Well, like the other weeks, I just noticed that everything makes me hungry. I spend half an hour on the course and then I have to go straight to the kitchen and find something to eat. It's great reading what everyone has to share about things from their countries, but it does make me hungry. Mm.
There are so many recipes on the Padlet that I'm definitely looking forward to try. Sally?
That's what I was going to say. The Padlets are amazing. Yeah. I mean, I've just been to have a look at them and they're just absolutely amazing. There's so much stuff there. There's cakes, there's breakfast, there's a whole Christmas lunch from Catalonia. Yeah. There's people making the recipes from the course as well. So there's lots of things called Neil's chicken tikka masala and lots of things called Tina's shepherd's pie.
And scones. Don't forget your scones.
Oh, my scones. Scones.
Scones. You couldn't resist.
Yeah. And it's lovely to see so many people using the word yummy and scrummy and some of those words that they've learned from the course, I think, especially from Tina. It's really great fun to see people using this new language they've got from the course.
Go on, Neil.
No, I was just gonna say, like you were saying, the photos, I mean, people have done such a fantastic job with these dishes as well. Some of them look better than the ones that we did this as the examples. They look really good.
But there's some really interesting sort of cultural things that I've learned this week. There's about for special days, like for birthdays, celebrating birthdays on like the 77th and 88th in Japan, I think someone said. I didn't know that. You know, rather than in Britain, I think we'd do the 70th and the 80th as the big birthdays.
Oh, I've seen also, I think in Mexico and Brazil, that 15th birthday is a big one for girls.
Yeah.
And then somewhere else, the 40th birthday is unlucky and it's not really celebrated. There were quite a few people.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
40th, tell me about it.
People have explained why. Like, why? That's what I like, those little bits of culture and finding out what people do in different countries.
Mm-hmm. And it reminded me of somebody was talking about ear pulling as a birthday thing, like pulling the ear for the number of years, which reminded me of the bumps, which we used to do.
Yeah.
We used to do the bumps.
You may have to explain what the bumps actually were.
Sorry.
The bumps. Okay, so the bumps is quite violent, I think. You hold the person, a group of people hold you by your arms and legs and kind of lift you in the air for the number of years that you're celebrating.
And do they not bang you on the ground as well?
Maybe in Scotland.
Well, I was going to say, maybe that's only in Scotland. I don't know. It was up and down onto the ground. Okay, fine. Character building. Yeah. But we have a question here that I think we should answer straight away from Mustafa M. Ghanim, because, of course, we have lots of people watching from the course, but we also have lots of people watching who are not on the course and maybe going, what are you talking about? So Mustafa's asking, how can I join this course, Chris?
Okay, well, Mustafa, it's really easy. In the comments here on Facebook, you'll find a link to the course. And then if you've never done a FutureLearn course before, you'll have to very quickly join FutureLearn. And then you can go straight to the course and just jump in and start watching video, reading some of the parts of the course that are all about food. It's completely free, and you can do it any way you want to. You can start in week four, start in week one. It's completely up to you, but it's really easy.
Great. Yep. And the link will keep popping up in the comments. So whenever you see it, just make sure you click on it and visit. I'm going to pop this comment up just because it's so nice. From Tamim Hassan, who's saying, great to see you. I'm from Bangladesh. I love your online meetings very much.
Okay, so thank you.
That's nice.
Okay, so just for anyone who's just joined us, we're here to talk about food and culture, anything connected with food in the UK, mealtimes, traditions, especially as Claire was saying, we've been looking at special celebrations and things this week. So any questions you have, just post them in the comments and we'll try and answer as many as we can. Let's begin with a question from the course. A nice, easy one to start us off with from Fekria Elamir. Sorry that I missed the last video live, but I enjoyed it. By the way, what is porridge? We spoke about porridge in the last live. So let's talk about it. What is porridge? Who wants to take that one?
Well, I mean, you're Scottish, but Claire, you're a porridge person, aren't you?
I'm a porridge fan, which I think I spoke about last time. I won't do that again. But porridge is it's a dish usually had for breakfast in the UK. It's made with oats and milk, or sometimes milk and water, heated up in a pot on the stove. And then you can serve it with sugar or fruit or honey or whatever you like on top. Fruits.
Pinch of salt as well, surely.
And, of course, a little bit of salt.
I'm a porridge person. I have porridge every day for breakfast. This week, I made the mistake of having barley porridge. Have you ever had barley porridge? I don't recommend it. Okay. But oats, great. Okay, moving on to our next question. From Claudia Rodriguez Alvarez. This Jeez. One, I think, has got Chris's name all over it. I'd like to know more about regional cheeses in the UK, British cheddar, and lots of difficult pronunciations for people who don't know these places, yeah. Gloucester, Red Leicester, etc. So, Chris.
Well, I think cheddar is probably the most famous British cheese. Would you agree, everyone? I mean, I think
yeah.
cheddar is
yeah, so, one yeah.
people know, but I don't think cheddar... I mean, I like cheddar, don't get me wrong. I love cheddar, but I don't think it's the most interesting or most exciting British cheese. No? Did somebody disagree there?
No, go on.
Controversial. That was oh, Claire's disappeared again from my camera. I know you can probably still see her. Carry on. Claire, can I just ask you to refresh one more time? Because if I can't see you, it probably means people outside in the big wide world can't see you. But let's go back to Chris and the cheese.
Yeah, but, well, it's all. Yeah, there are lots of great cheeses around Britain. There are lots of great cheeses in Scotland.
Okay, what's going on? What's happened?
I don't know. I'm still here.
No, Chris is.
You are, yeah.
Yes. Okay. Ah. Chris, you're back. Sorry.
maybe someone's gone for cheese. I don't know.
Refresh, Neil?
I don't know what Claudia wanted to know exactly. I mean, there are cheeses from all over the country. I don't think there's not one part of the country that is especially famous for its cheese. Each part of the country has its cheese or different cheeses. Hard cheeses, like cheddar is at the harder end, but I don't think we do many really soft cheeses.
Hello, we're back.
Yeah, I've never been away. I was talking all the time.
Okay, we're having a few technical difficulties at the moment. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to leave Chris to talk a little bit more about cheese
Thank you.
For a second while I just disappear temporarily, and I'll be back in a moment, okay?
Well, I'm just looking at some of the comments that Kate Palmiero mentions that they can get cheddar in the country where she is.
And you can get different types of cheddar, can't you, Chris?
Well,
that's one of the best UK cheeses myself. And you can get different kinds. You can get mild, you can get mature cheddar, which is much more of a stronger or a sharper taste.
Mm.
You can get vintage cheddar, which is like the really old one that's really, really strong.
But
can I tell you a quick story about my cat?
No.
Where is she? She's not here. Okay, my cat is a cheese snob. She loves vintage cheddar, but will not touch any other cheddar. Try her with mild cheddar or mature cheddar, turns her nose up at it and walks away. It has to be vintage cheddar, aged minimum 36 months. There you go. Okay. Right.
What are your favorites? I mean, it's an everyday cheese, but I really like Red Leicester, which is one of the ones that Claudia mentioned, which is a sort of red orange colored cheese. And for a cheese sandwich, I would probably choose Red Leicester. How about you? What are your cheese choices?
Sally?
Ah, am I here?
You are indeed, yes.
Okay. I've got something displaying differently for me on the screen. What's my favourite cheese? I really like Stilton.
Mm. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I love Stilton, but it wouldn't be much the cheese that I would have every day, like in a cheese sandwich. I think I would have cheddar, actually.
Okay.
And also, I like, what's that crumbly one? Cheshire.
Well, I was going to say Cheshire was my
favorite. Lancashire, also crumbly.
Mm. Cheshire does not seem to travel. I've never been able to find Cheshire outside the UK any place. You know, other ones, Cheddar, Stilton, things like that. Yeah, but Cheshire is a really tough one to find, but it is lovely.
Yeah. You can get it I'm in Barcelona. You can get it in the market here, definitely. Right. But it's, you want it for a special occasion because it's expensive.
Mm.
But cheddar you can get in the supermarkets.
Kate Palmiro saying, I'm in Sicily, but no cheddar here.
Oh, no.
Yeah, but I'm sure you have great cheeses in Sicily,
yeah.
Kate.
Yeah.
Italian
cheeses.
I'm
wondering about the names of cheeses, because in the UK, the cheese, I think they're all named after the place where it's made, right?
So mostly,
either the
yeah.
town, like cheddar is
a I'm place, getting some, I'm getting, or... losing some sound. I'm just going to refresh, Neil.
Okay.
For a second, okay?
Okay. This has been a weird day. We don't normally have these technical problems, but today, for some reason, we're having lots of glitches. So bear with us. It will all be fine soon. Claire, you were saying?
I was saying cheese is named after the place where it's made. You know, like wine is often named after maybe that's the grape, isn't it? But I was wondering if it's the same in other languages where you have cheese. So Italian cheeses, are they named after the place? And French cheese, is that named after the place? I would love people to tell us in the comments if that's
good question. Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. That's good. Quick question from Ram Kumar Kadka. Are you all from England?
Well, I am from England. I'm from the north of England, from a city called Sunderland.
And Claire?
Well, I call myself British because I'm half Welsh and half English, but I grew up in the northwest of England.
And I'm from Scotland. And Sally has just joined us again.
I'm back. I'm from England. I'm from the north of England, from Sheffield.
Great. Okay, quick question here from Nancy Acosta. I'd like to know if you have brunch only on Saturdays. An interesting question. First of all, maybe we should talk a little bit for anyone who doesn't know about brunch, and then do you have brunch at all? And if you do, when do you have it?
Well, Chris, Claire, you were talking about words like brunch on the course with someone, weren't you? So brunch is a combination of breakfast and lunch, and what's that called? It's a portmanteau word, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Two words to make a new one.
Yeah, so brunch is, I would say it's usually a bit bigger than breakfast, maybe a bit smaller than lunch, and you eat it sometime between a usual breakfast time and a usual lunch time. Mm. So I think probably the reason people do it at the weekends is because other days they're at work, so it's difficult to have brunch when you know at that sort of 10, 11 o'clock in the morning because usually you're at work. Mm-hmm. But to be honest, Nancy, I hardly ever have brunch.
I have brunch. I love brunch. I have brunch maybe once a month, usually out someplace, but it's on a Sunday, not a Saturday usually.
Yeah.
Sally, how about you?
Same as you, Neil. Yeah. Yeah. And normally it would be somewhere out, right? Or if everybody gets up late, maybe we'll have brunch at home then. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. But obviously it's been difficult for the last year because nowhere was open.
Yeah, well, that's true.
We've got a whole conversation going on in the you've started something off, Chris. We've got a whole conversation going on in the comments about cheese. Started off with Gallo Galileo, why don't you try pecorino? And then what kind of, it depends what type of pecorino, matured pecorino, whole conversation is going on about cheese. They're not even listening to us anymore.
Right. Pecorino is sheep cheese, isn't it, pecorino?
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. We've got some other ones. This one sounds lovely. I'd love to try that. Garuda cheese with cumin. Have any of you heard of that?
Oh, no, it sounds lovely.
I'll certainly be looking that one up after we finish this. Okay. Right, let's move on to some more questions. Maria Isabel, this is great because this is exactly what we've been talking about this week. Not National Day necessarily, and maybe we'll have to talk about that because we don't really have a National Day as such, but what do you eat to celebrate your National Day? So let's talk about some of the special days that we do eat something special.
Because we don't really celebrate national days, do we? Or at least
the English don't. The Scottish might, maybe.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, the English don't.
Sorry. Yeah, and I don't know about the way. I mean, we have, of course, St. Andrew's Day, St. George's Day, St. David's Day, and so on. But I don't think there's any special food connected with them. I don't know, maybe.
Well,
I don't think so.
No.
So, but what special days do we celebrate with special food? I mean, you mentioned, Claire, in your introduction, you mentioned obviously about Christmas that I think everyone knows, but are there any other kind of special days that are celebrated with special food?
So in our last live, we talked about parkin, which is a special cake that you can have on November the 5th, bonfire night. So we have mm-hmm. special food around that time of year, and I think that goes with Halloween as well. End of October, so things like toffee apples, what else? Treacle toffee, which is a very sticky sweet made of caramelized sugar and just hardened that you break your teeth on. And then we've got Easter food around Easter, I think we do, isn't it? Those spring. Yeah. So we have lamb perhaps as a Sunday roast, and then there are cakes for Easter as well. There's Simnel cake, which used to be a cake for Mother's Day, which women who were working in service, domestic workers, maids, if you like, would bake this cake and take it home to their mothers for Mother's Day because they'd get the day off. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
And, of course, Pancake Day. Don't forget Pancake Day as well, of course.
Yeah.
And then in Scotland, we have Burns Night, of course, in January, when we have our haggis and neeps and tatties and so on.
Yeah, and that's on the course as well. Genevieve mm-hmm. talks about haggis on the course and how lovely it is, and she's convinced some people. and in the comments there, Charles Carroll, who's a regular on the course, is talking about leeks for St. David's Day in Wales. A food associated with Wales is the leek, the long vegetable we've talked about before, but I'm not sure that people eat leeks. You sometimes wear a daffodil or a leek on the Welsh National Day, but Claire, you're the most Welsh of us, the people.
no one in my family has anything, but that's not to say that some people, you know, maybe they do that. I'll be interested to find out, actually, but no one I know. Someone's asking about parkin as well, and I think we should put a link to that.
We're going to move on there to some
spicy
different
cake
topics. Because this is a question for Chris based on your last video from Juliana. You've got a beautiful garden. I'd like to know what's the name of that beautiful blue flower I've seen next to your blue bench on your video. Sorry that my question is not about food. Maybe you can make some soup out of the flowers. I don't know. But anyway, what are the flowers that we're talking about here?
Well, Juliana, First of all, thank you for saying that about the small garden at the front of the house. However, the expert is not me. So I need to ask her. And I know the blue flower you're talking about, and I know that I got into trouble for saying it was a thistle. So I can tell you that it's not a thistle, but I'll leave a comment later and tell you what kind of flower it is. I'll answer your question in the comments later.
I thought it was a thistle as well. So good. So I'll learn something.
I think it's a sea thistle or something that grows by the seaside. Yeah.
So okay. this is from your end of week video, isn't it? Your video review that you did the other week. Yeah.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, that's where I can put the comment. I'll put on that step the names of the flowers you can see.
Okay. Now this is a question that's a wild card here. Let's see if we can do anything with this or not. From Alex Zilla, some food idioms or proverbs concerning food, such as "cool as a cucumber." Do we have some more?
Do you know the conversation on the course with food? Sayings that we can link to, and people are putting in sayings from their own language as well. It's amazing how many of them are similar between languages, like everything in moderation, about how you should eat, you know, not too much of everything. But sorry, Sally. Yeah. Hot potato, tell us what that means.
Hot potato, that's one. So let's see if we can just throw in a couple for Alex here. So we've got cool as a cucumber, a hot potato, anything
else? A piece of cake.
Easy as pie.
What did you say, Claire?
Easy as pie.
Easy as pie.
Yeah.
Okay. Cheesy.
Okay. Cheesy.
Is that a food? It's not really a food idiom, is it?
Top banana, somebody's put in the, comments.
Top banana.
Hot potato.
Go bananas as well. Go bananas.
Yeah, go bananas. Couch potato, another good one.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's move on. Kate Palmyra is just saying, but brunch is not a British thing. It's true. I mean, I think it comes from the US originally as an idea, but it's global now. I think you can get brunch anywhere in the world within that. Right, one question. Something else that we've talked about in the course, and all of these questions that people are asking that we say you've talked about in the course, that's a great reason for you to join the course, because we cover so much fantastic information about the history, culture, the development of food in the UK and what food means. All these questions that people are asking here, you can find the answers in videos and much more detail and articles on the course. So go and check it out. But this question from Francesca from Rome is saying, is it true that fish and chips isn't originally an English dish? I read somewhere that it's been introduced by a Jewish cook. Thank you. What can we say about the history of fish and chips? We talk about it on the course. Chris?
Well, yes, you're right, Francesca, that fried fish probably came to the UK. One theory is that it was Jewish merchants in, can you remember, was it the 18th or 19th century? And the same with fried potatoes. I mean, like lots of things in Britain, lots of language, lots of food, lots of different things have come from different places. I think people think that probably the combination of this fried fish with fried potatoes happened in Britain, was a British combination. Mm-hmm. But like most things, the different parts came from different places.
Yeah. And you can certainly see that it's developed. It was taken further in the UK. Because, I mean, if you've eaten fish and chips in many different countries or variations, it's quite unique. It started from someplace else, but it's been as many things. Like the chicken tikka masala we talked about as well. It's been given a twist and made unique by the way it's done there. Okay. Kwok Tang Kaubui saying, is rice a main dish in everyday meals in the UK? Do British people eat rice as a main dish like people in Southeast Asian countries do? So let's start by asking, let's take a quick poll. How often do you eat rice with your meals?
Well, I had risotto yesterday.
Okay.
We're going to have rice for dinner today.
Okay.
I had chili with rice yesterday. I probably have it 3 or 4 times a week.
So I think that's a yes to the first question, Emily. Yes, it is part of everyday meals in the UK. And do we eat it as a main dish? Well, Chris did yesterday.
I think we do. It's not necessarily a staple. People in Britain, maybe, I don't know, this is a sweeping statement, maybe they have potatoes more often than they have rice.
What do you think? I don't think that's a sweeping statement. I think that's true. I think potatoes are still a big part of our diet. Chris, would you agree?
Yeah, I would agree that if you're going to have a carbohydrate, like, then it's more likely to be potato than rice. Mm. Potato or bread, really, yeah.
And pasta. So we mix it up quite a lot in the UK, don't we? Yeah. It's not only rice or only potatoes.
I have no empirical basis for this, but I would say if I was making a chart, I would guess it's going to be potato, pasta, rice in terms of popularity or frequency. I don't know. What do you think?
We should do a poll.
Yes. If we could, should have thought of this. We could have had one now. Okay. Let's move on to some more questions. Here's a good one from Partha Sarathi Paul. Could you name any Indian food? I could spend the next 20 minutes doing nothing else.
You know, that's a really good question, because we talk on the course about how in the UK we say Indian food and we actually mean not necessarily food that's only from India, but we put a lot of things under that umbrella, don't we? Like especially Bangladeshi food and Pakistani food. I would be a bit unsure about what I'm saying. I don't know if it's Indian or, you know, which country it's from.
And
I'm
the same, Claire.
Yeah, because then there's that other thing about some of those dishes that are very familiar to us in Indian restaurants. And as you say, an Indian restaurant is probably a Bangladeshi restaurant in the UK. Mm-hmm. But some of those dishes that are really familiar names, like Madras and, you know, the different things we're used to, actually might not be typical food in India or in Bangladesh.
Partha, maybe you can tell us some. But I was thinking about naan, about alu gobi, sagaloo, those kind of biryani again. Yeah. I don't know if that's
the thing that springs to mind to me is samosas, because that's what they sell in the shop around the corner here.
But yes, I mean, it's a good point that basically Indian food is used in, as you say, in the UK to basically refer to a whole range of South Asian food. You're right. I mean, but we do have individual restaurants more and more which actually specify, I think, you know, different within that. But I mean, traditionally in the past, as Chris said, chefs were from Bangladesh, the dishes were from Bangladesh, but we, you know, they were called Indian restaurants, which is interesting as well. Okay, let's move on. This is just a comment here. It's not a question. I'm just going to put it up because it's there. Why not? From Manuel Gordillo. Cucumber is such a popular vegetable, but I can't eat it. They're so bad for your stomach. I'm sorry to hear. I love, you know, one thing that's always thought of as very traditionally British is cucumber sandwiches. And I love cucumber sandwiches. Mm. Am I alone in this?
Yes.
Just cucumber. Only cucumber.
Butter, cucumber, and a sprinkling of salt. Yes.
No. But cucumber with something like peanut butter or cheese, maybe?
Tuna.
Peanut butter and cucumber, okay.
Yeah. Have you seen any of those videos on the internet of cats and cucumbers?
Yes. So it seems that not only Manuel doesn't like cucumber.
Well, cats, we always talk about your cat, so, you know.
Yeah, but I have not tried the cucumber thing because it's cruel.
I think it's cruel. It's frightening cats.
Mm. Frightening cats is never a good thing. Okay.
Anyway, Manuel, I think if you take the skin off the cucumber, it's not so bad for stomach.
Yeah, it's usually the skin that causes the digestion problems with that. Yeah, I don't peel mine. I love the skin, but lots of people, my mother always used to peel them as well and so on. Okay, here's a question that's a direct, a shoo-in for lockdown question from Jana Rashkowskienie, because one thing that's been all over the internet, all over YouTube, Instagram, TikTok during lockdown has been people's baking experiments. And the question is, Do British people eat rye sourdough bread nowadays? I don't know if you've been following this, but sourdough bread baking was like a mad craze over the last year or so. Claire?
Everyone I know has made sourdough bread over the last year.
Yep.
Apart from me.
That was going to be my next question. Okay, fine. Have you eaten your friend's sourdough bread?
Yes, I don't like it.
You don't like it? Okay.
No, it's too kind of so chewy and hard. Maybe it's the way they've made it.
Okay. Chris, you look like a man that's handy with a bread maker.
I was ahead of the curve here because I was making sourdough bread 3 or 4 years ago, where, you know, somebody gave me the starter and you need to look after it and feed it. Mm-hmm. And the bread I made was much better than your friend's bread, Claire. It was fantastic. And I bought a proper basket to shape the bread, and I had to stop because I was eating so much bread. Go on, sorry.
I was going to say, I feel really sorry for Claire's friend now, who no doubt knows who they are. And, you know,
no, it's like I'm not going to say any names.
They'll never bake sourdough bread again.
I love it. I love it. But it's an occasional treat now because I don't want to eat as much bread as I would.
I've never tried it, to be honest, but I know during lockdown, a lot of friends were passing messages on WhatsApp about how to make different types of bread, including sourdough bread. But what I don't really know what it is, I'm afraid. How does it taste differently to normal bread?
It's not as nice.
It's like normal bread, only nicer and completely.
Oh, okay, right. That's cleared it up for me. Thanks.
That explains it.
Okay. So if anyone watching makes sourdough bread, likes sourdough bread, or like Claire clearly does not like sourdough bread, let us know in the comments, okay? Quick comment from Khadija Argani, who's saying, and this is something we talk about on the course as well, you're lucky to have all these international foods in the UK. It's something special we don't have so much in our country. And that's been something people have talked about a lot, isn't it? Anyone who wants to answer me there.
Well, we do talk about it in the course. And yes, I think it is true that, you know, as we say in the course, British cuisine might not be the most famous cuisine in the world, might not be the best cuisine in the world. But if you live in Britain, you have access to food from all over the world. Not just in London, but all over the country, you can find a range of eating opportunities, eating choices.
Yeah, okay. Bear with me for just a second because I saw something. Okay, a lot of discussion. So I'll tell you, just if you're not following the comments there, the two hottest topics so far, the two that have got people really talking to each other in the comments, are cheese and rice. They're going off on that. There's lots of talking about that. Lots of people talking about how they eat rice, what they eat rice with. Claudia saying, complimenting what Christiana said, in Brazil, we eat rice as a staple, usually combined with beans. I love rice and beans. It's a delicious, delicious meal. And we're now getting lots of people. We've talked about Indian food. This is one that I certainly know Chris and I can talk about because we've shared a few of these in the past, which is, do you know any Vietnamese food? Are you fans of Vietnam? I love Vietnamese food. I used to live in Vietnam, and it's one of my absolute favorites. Claire as well. Sally's nodding too.
Yeah, I like it. I don't know any names of it, to be honest. I just know Vietnamese food from going to a Vietnamese restaurant, and it was really, really, really nice. That's all I can say.
I know Po, but I don't know if that's how you say it, the kind of the soup you get everywhere with it. It's delicious.
I'm avoiding saying it as well because I also don't know how to pronounce it. It looks.
That's okay. Don't be shy. Yeah. I'm sure someone will help us and tell us how we say.
What was interesting on the course was lots of Vietnamese and also from other parts of Southeast Asia were saying that they eat pho for breakfast.
Yeah. When I was in Vietnam a couple of years ago, making the videos for the IELTS course, I had pho for breakfast every day. And it was just fantastic. So what a great way to start the day.
Wow.
And I love the coffee that you get in Vietnam, the iced coffee.
Yeah. Killer coffee. I mean, it's just so strong. It's great. So yes, is the answer to that question. We know it and we love it. And okay, any other countries that want to ask pop up, I'm sure we love them all. So, okay. Moving on. Yeah, lots of stuff that's put down there from questions. This is a really good question. I like this one from Din Ti Can Lin. Could you share a most delicious dish you have tried many times after failure? So I think what we're talking about here is one that we've tried to cook and failed at, and hopefully finally been able to do a good job of. That's a good one, Sally.
That's a good question. It makes me think of my Yorkshire puddings, actually. Mm-hmm. It's very simple food. And we can put a recipe for Yorkshire puddings if you don't know what they are, but it's a savoury, it's like pancakes, but small, and it's savoury, and you have it with a Sunday dinner. But it's quite hard to get them to rise properly. And like, I remember one Christmas I made them, and they were just completely flat and hard, like horrible little pancakes. And then I realised the secret was to get the oil really, really, really hot. And now hopefully, fingers crossed, they always come out nice.
I've still never succeeded with Yorkshire pudding, so I'll need to follow your advice on that. Chris, anything you've tried and failed and then not failed?
Well, I can certainly do the tried and failed part. But I'm thinking in particular that when I went to India and I had a meal in India, and it was really very simple. But maybe one of the greatest meals I've ever eaten, and it was with chickpeas. It was vegetarian, and it was fantastic. And when I came home, I spent ages looking for the ingredient in small shops and things, and I made it, and it was terrible. And then I tried again, and it was terrible. I just can't recreate this fantastic meal I had in a small place in Delhi about 10 years ago.
Mm. Claire?
I think pastry in general, particularly quiche. So if you've ever seen Mary Berry, anyone watching this, the famous British baker Mary Berry, she talks about quiches having a soggy bottom, and that's what happened with my quiche. So the pastry at the bottom was always soggy. Eventually I got it right, and for me the key is blind baking. So you bake the pastry first, weighted down with, personally I use chickpeas to weight it down, and then fill it and bake it again. But it took me a long time to get that right, to get pastry right.
For me, it's something really simple. Roast duck. I didn't eat duck for years unless I was eating it out, because whenever I tried to make it, it just wasn't very good. And I finally got it right just last Christmas. And that was by cooking at a much, much lower heat for 3 hours or 3 or 4 hours, breast down, and then turning it. And, you know, it took me years to do that. Every duck I ever cooked was just dry and horrible and a disaster. So always learning. That's good. Okay.
That was a good question.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. What did you say?
I said it was a good question.
Yeah.
It was. And I'd like to hear about other people as well, or if you've tried making any British dishes, how easy or difficult you found it. Maybe you could let us know.
Yeah.
It's been really good on the course so far. Most of the ones I've seen, I don't know, maybe you've heard of some failures, but most of the ones I've read, it's been people who have tried them, and they've been really happy with the results. It's been really successful, and they've really enjoyed them.
That's because the demonstration videos are so good and so clear. Neil and Sally and Tina as well, who made them.
Have you seen any comments from anyone who has, like, you know, had problems and asked for any follow-up advice?
No.
Okay, great. Even better. Okay, we're over time, so I just have time for a couple of quick questions here. We had a question from Janet already, but I really like this question, so I'm just going to throw it up very quickly. Do British people go to the woods to pick mushrooms for food? Chris, you're the person who's probably closest to nature for this kind of thing.
Well, I think the short answer is probably not. And I don't know where you're from, Jana, but I used to live in Slovakia, where, you know, in that part of the world, in the Czech Republic and Slovakia, it's very common that people go out into the woods to search for mushrooms. And I think when you do that from a very young age, you know which mushrooms are okay and which mushrooms will kill you very quickly. And in Britain, we don't have that expertise. So when you find a mushroom in the woods, then, or if I find a mushroom in the woods, I'm looking through my little mushroom book and thinking, well, maybe it's this one, which is delicious, or maybe it's this one, which is incredibly poisonous. And I just don't have the confidence to select the mushrooms from the woods.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. As I say, just a few very quick questions. This is talking about what we just spoke about. Luna Huang's got one here. Do you have any tips for making pancakes? I can't make them. I've tried hundreds of times and I've never been successful. Before I ask any of you for tips here, I just want to say we actually have a really good recipe video on our Facebook page here. I'll share it after this live, or maybe Tina can share it now. But we have a really good recipe. If you follow that, I think your pancakes will be good. But anyone Sally, Claire, Chris, any pancake tips to share with Huang just now?
I think get the pan really hot and use butter as rather than oil, and then always throw the first one away. The second one will be good.
That's true.
The first one's always a mess, don't worry about that. I would also say keep your mixture in the fridge for a while before you make it, and make sure you really stir it really, really well. I use a whisk to whisk it up. Mm.
Why is the first one always a disaster? It's true with me too.
Because it's not hot enough, I think.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, maybe, yeah.
I don't know. It's just, it's always wrong.
Well, this is my British Council MasterChef.
Okay, another very quick question from Sarah Chelsea. What is a haggis? I'm not sure I want to go into the details too much, because for our vegetarian viewers, it's probably a bit disturbing, but it's a kind of, I guess, sausagey type thing, which is organ meat from a sheep mixed with some oats and spices in a sheep's stomach, boiled. And it's delicious, although from my description there, it certainly doesn't sound it. Okay.
Did you see the question from Alex, which is Tina has highlighted somewhere, saying what national English food do you miss when you live abroad for a long time? That's a nice
question. I didn't see that one. Okay, good.
I think
I'll try and find it. Okay. Okay. Well, let me ask Claire first then. What national food do you miss? There, got it.
It's funny you ask that, because my husband brought home triumphantly yesterday from the supermarket here something that I really miss, and that is crumpets. I don't really know how to explain crumpets. It's sort of a bready thing that you put in the toaster. It's delicious, and you have it with hot with butter, and it's just beautiful. And there's no way I can make them, so I miss crumpets, and now I've got some in my freezer.
Crumpets are difficult to describe, aren't they? Because they're not really, they're not like a roll or bread. They're not like a pancake. They're some kind of, I don't know, how would you describe a crumpet to somebody who'd never eaten one? Sally.
I'd just show them a picture. Sally, what do you think?
They're kind of rubbery and spongy, aren't they?
Yeah, they're kind of bouncy, kind of, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh. And you can only eat them toasted. They're terrible if you try to eat them straight out of the thing.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Okay, I think we have to stop now. Let me just have a very quick scroll through the questions to see if there are any. Oh, some people sharing good tips here. From Oksana, the main ingredient for pancakes is egg. Put in 5 eggs and not too much milk, and add flour. Okay, so some good tips there. And Olga is also saying what Claire said as well, or sorry, Sally said as well, which heat the frying pan, make sure that it's hot enough before you start. So great to see lots of sharing of advice and tips in the comments, and some really busy conversations, as I say, about cheese and rice and other things here. Okay, very last question, if I can find one. Okay, lots of people asking us about lots of food around the world. Polish food, Sri Lankan food, Malaysian food. I think I can say yes to everything.
I'm hungry again.
I'm starving. I'm going to have a crumpet after this.
Okay, let's make this the last question. Number one, other than traditional British food, what would be your favorite food? And secondary question, is there any country's food that you haven't tried that you would like to try? Perhaps you've seen on the Padlet for the menus, or perhaps it's just been something you've seen on the internet and often thought, I'd love to try that. Sally.
Well, I was just looking through the Padlet today, mm-hmm. and there's another photo of the dish that you made, Claire. The Mexican dish, huevos divorciados, which you made.
Oh, I did, yeah, it's lovely.
And there's a new picture of that from a different person. It just looks amazing. It's like a work of art. It's different colours, isn't it? It's red and green with eggs. Yeah. And I want to try that, and I'm going to try and make that.
Yeah, I haven't made that one yet, but it's definitely top of my list as well. Also because it has such a great name. Okay, Chris?
Well, I can't think of anything that I've not tried that I want to, but what I would like to go further into Georgian food. Because the Georgian food I've tried has been fantastic, but I've not tried very much of it. You know, so Khachapuri, everyone knows, but I'd really like to explore more Georgian food right now, actually.
No, I agree. I'm with you there. I mean, it wasn't in Georgia, but there's a wonderful Georgian restaurant in Krakow in Poland where I had just one of the best meals I think I've ever had anywhere. It was fantastic. Still remember it to this day. In fact, it's made me hungry now. Claire?
I think because of the course, I want to try Brazilian food. Mm. It just sounds a really interesting mix. And there's lots of recipes been shared and I've bookmarked them. So I'm going to try some. And also food from Myanmar as well. I'm interested in. I don't know much about it, and I'm learning more about it through the course. So they're on my list.
I've been to Myanmar, and the food was fantastic. I have to say, yes, really magnificent. I never had anything there from breakfast to dinner that I didn't really enjoy. Okay, we've run out of time. We've gone over time by quite a lot for this, but it is our last Facebook Live of the course, so I think we can afford that for the people that are there. Because it's our last Facebook Live of the course, it's the last week of the course. Just as I said at the beginning, the course is not closed or anything. If you want to join the course, follow the links. You can join the course now. But we've been here for 4 weeks, going through the course, talking about each step. Last words or final words, messages for people watching. I'll just go around in a circle. I'm going to start with Chris, then Sally, then Claire. So Chris.
What was the question?
Final messages for people watching.
I'm just reading the comments. Claire's made lots of people in Brazil very happy by saying she wants to try Brazilian food. Final message is thank you to everyone. All of us, as we've said, have so much fun reading your comments, finding new things to eat, new things to cook. So just a big thank you to everyone who's taken part and shared a meal with us in the course.
Okay. Sally?
thanks for joining us here and for joining us on the course. And also thanks for all your questions, which we obviously haven't had time to answer all of them today. But if you do join the course, you can carry on the conversation there, and that would be fantastic to see you there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Claire.
This is sort of a quote from someone on the course, Costanza, who said that the course gave her a deeper insight into her own food and culture, and that's how I feel too. It's made me think about British food and the habits that we have. So please join the course and find out more about UK food, and also tell us about your culture too.
Okay, fantastic. And it has been a great course. And I just want to say thank you to everyone who's been watching today for all of your great questions. And I've loved the conversations you're having with each other. And so many countries asking about food. The answer to have we tried them is yes for all of them for me. But then look at me, obviously. I like them all. Okay, but thank you for all your great questions. If you're on the course, we really appreciate all the conversations you've had there. If you're not on the course yet and you're watching, just click the link and join. It's completely free. And I think, as you can see from all the comments today, you will enjoy it and you'll get a lot from it. Okay, so thanks and bye for now.
Bye.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.